There's the gap between urban culture, which is black culture to me, and commercial content. Because when I look at commercial content, I see black content, you know? So I just feel like it's time we capitalize on our own narratives and on our own culture that's, you know, that's being broadcasted to the entire world. But yeah, so that's what I'm currently focused on now.
Nice.
I'll go. My name is Ashley. I graduated Dorsey in 2015. And then I went to UCLA, graduated in 2019. And now I'm a writer, so I do ghostwriting. I had a book published that I ghost wrote in 2021, so last year. And I also am the CEO of my own management company, so I manage talent like models, photographers, stylists, singers, and I'm just passionate about putting people in my community in dope spaces like commercials, movies, music videos, campaigns. So yeah.
Nice. Roman.
Okay. My name is Roman. I am the co-founder of multiple businesses and the CEO of maybe like two or three different businesses. One of them is The Juice Man. Another one is Romans International, which is a management company. And then I'm co-founder of Haven May and Haven May Global USA, which is a bag company. I grew up in the Merck Park off of Degnan and Stocker. I was recruited to Dorsey because of my athleticism. So Coach Dave is, you know, my original coach when it comes to football. Sorry, give me one second.
I got you.
All right, sorry, I had a call come in. I was an entrepreneur at Dorsey as well. I graduated 2016 and I pursued my passion for technology after that. That's me.
Ashley and Alton, y'all didn't get to, and Lario, where did y'all grow up? What part of LA? I think that's pretty cool.
She can go first.
I grew up in Baldwin Hills, Los Angeles, so South Central LA.
I grew up in South Central LA as well, specifically in Baldwin Village in the jungles. Oh, and I graduated from Morehouse too, class of 2019.
Yes, nice.
I grew up in the South Central area as well, the jungles over here closer near Dorsey. And I didn't touch on as far as schooling. I graduated from Marymount University in 2019. I'm currently still there now. I'm in my last semester of my MBA program, which I'll be graduating this year. And as far as my career choice, I'm currently a behavioral support therapist, which is basically working with youth from 5 all the way to 17, and also including adults with any autistic traits or any behavioral intervention that may need to be contrived, whether it's in a house, whether it's in the school, just basically being that person for that person to talk through and live their everyday life.
Nice, y'all. Well, thank y'all for joining. I know it was kind of like abrupt when I got y'all to join, but y'all said yes and y'all are here, so I really appreciate y'all. I really feel like the students are going to appreciate y'all for, you know, taking the time to speak with them as well. But all right, let's get right into it. What activities or clubs were you all involved in while y'all were at Dorsey? What y'all have going on?
Oh, I could start with that one. I was involved with the robotics program in the Magnet part of Dorsey. That was literally some of the best time of my life. I thought that I was going to be a professional athlete because I was so good at it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know, I've always had a passion about technology. And Dr. Mahdi was the pioneer of that situation. I remember, you know, once I think this was maybe like 11th grade when that robotics program was available to me. There was also another program, I can't think of the name right now, but it was doing coding. Those two programs were literally, those were like the best moments of my life. I got to discover, you know, what I really wanted to do. I also got internship offers from Microsoft and Google through those Torsi programs as well. So I got a lot of exposure in gaming and programming robots. I did competitions at Dorsey, building robots, the same software that Tesla uses to self-drive their cars is the same software that I was learning in Dr. Amati's class. So I got a lot of technology exposure at Dorsey, and you know, I don't know, like that gave me the inspiration and the motive to you know, just do what I'm doing today. So I really have Dorsey to thank for that.
Nice. That's really cool. Alton, go ahead.
Oh yeah, I was in the magnet program, 9th through 12th grade. I loved the magnet program. I was like a cool kid, I guess, or whatever, but a cool kid in the magnet, so all my homies used to like clown me for being smart or whatever. But I didn't care. I was used to that my whole life. I played on the varsity team, basketball at Dorsey. I made the varsity team my 11th grade year. I was the only student from the freshman sophomore that made varsity. Skip JV, because I was averaging 30 points a game. And they didn't give us, we was undefeated and we was in no tournaments. But the next year, the next sophomore team was in all the tournaments and didn't win a game. Nah, that's another story. But yeah, those were the main two clubs, and the magnet program and the basketball varsity program are the two I was in. But I got cut from the basketball team my senior year by Coach Gidd. If you ask me, I don't know why, or at the time I didn't know why, but in retrospect, it's probably because I was gangbanging.
Yeah. So you were playing sports and gangbanging, or you said?
Yeah, living a double life the whole time, and it didn't work out for me. I ended up, so my senior year I got cut. And I remember Gid told me, like, you know, still come to practice, you know, you can come to the games and I'll find you a school to get into at the end of the year. More than likely, like a junior college or something. And I went to a couple practices, I went to a couple games, and I just didn't feel right, like still playing hard and not being able to play. I just felt like detached from the team. So I stopped going to practice, started ditching and shooting dice and hopping the gate, going to the jungles, and I ended up getting locked up 2 months before my high school graduation. And I ended up getting my whole GED and high school diploma, both of them in juvenile hall. But wow. I still thank Dorsey for getting me that far, you know, because you look at my record, I probably should have got kicked out in 9th grade. Right?
Yeah. Thank you, Alton.
I'll go. I was in a lot of clubs at Dorsey, if I can think back. I was in the greenhouse program. So I really actually liked the greenhouse program. That was actually a program that I wasn't interested in at all. But it gave me like a sense of like caring about the nature in my community, you know, caring about the, if someone throws trash on the floor, you know, or, you know, trying to keep up with our own, you know, community and stuff. So we would go to different places and, you know, help restore our community. We would go to the Baldwin Hills Scenic Overlook, plant things. I think that was a great program for me to be in because it gave me a little bit more of a wider scope of things and different career paths or even just different things for me to be mindful of. I was also in decathlon for about a year. Decathlon was a lot, but I felt like it was good. I felt like being in decathlon was great. It was a great experience. One of the biggest, I guess, clubs or teams I was part of, was the biggest part of my life was softball. I made the varsity softball team when I was in ninth grade. And from there, that kind of has catapulted my whole life. That's what got me through college. From me not being in that club or participating that in Dorsey, I wouldn't have got my scholarship to be able to pay for my schooling. And at that time, I didn't have the resources or the funds to pay for school, to pay for college at that time. So I did focus on my talents and basically said, okay, I'm fast enough. I feel like I'm good enough where someone will definitely get me to pay, play for the university. So the Dorsey team was great to me. The coach was great. Coach Dave was great. Definitely stayed on us on the field and off the field, which is something that I feel that all students should know, whether you're an athlete or not. I feel like staying focused would definitely pay off. Like, don't think we're too much older or too much far along. I'm 24. I'm not that far off from you guys. And I definitely will say being a part of different communities or different clubs can definitely push you in different directions. Another two clubs that I was a part of, which were outside of Dorsey, but I heard about them from Dorsey, was Brotherhood Crusade and Community Coalition. These were actually community programs within the area, basically off of like off of Vernon and Crenshaw, where they helped with paying for our textbooks, getting us to and from different conferences, helped us with making resumes. Those programs definitely helped me as well. I got access to those from going to the Career Center at Dorsey. And even though that particular program wasn't at Dorsey, Dorsey did direct me into a program that could help me. Because I feel like if you're a senior, you know, right now, or even a junior at this time, this is the time we think about those things where, hey, where are we going to get these resources from? We do need that extra, you know, $50 to pay for the application fee. And some of us don't have it, you know, and we should definitely push and try to get to these different resources in our community. They're here for us to help. So those are something that's, all those programs coupled all together has definitely put me where I am today.
Nice.
Well, mm-hmm. I'll go. I was in the magnet program as well, and I can for sure say without the magnet program in Dorsey, I would not have gotten into UCLA. Like, the resources that Dorsey provided me with, and my counselor, I hate that I cannot remember her name, but she literally put me in the best position and just made sure that everything was squared away for all of my applications and helped me from literally beginning to end. So I'm super thankful for the magnet program. I did volleyball too as well, varsity volleyball for 11th grade, 12th grade. Was the class president my senior year. I don't know if that was like if we had an organization for it. Well, school government, so that was really cool. It made me fall in love with leadership and just making sure that my class
was good.
Oh, cool. And what else did I do? What else? Oh, I did mock trial with Dr. Singleton, and we would practice law and travel to different schools and like debate against different classes, and that was really, really cool. But Dorsey, just in general, if I wasn't at Dorsey, I don't know if I would be doing any of the things I'm doing now. Like, even the people I met at Dorsey, they really paved the way that I saw my career and where I wanted my life to go. So I rep Dorsey so hard anywhere I go, for sure.
Nice. DDP for life. Yeah, I love it. All right, y'all. What career path did you choose after high school, and why? Whoever wants to go.
Okay, I'll go again.
Oh.
After high school, I always said I wanted to be a writer. Well, in general, I always knew I wanted to be in the entertainment industry, but I just never wanted to be like the forefront of it. I don't like being on camera, and I'd rather just be behind the scenes. So I started off with writing. My passion was like writing TV shows and movies, but it's kind of hard to just like break into that when you don't really have the funding or the resources, or you just don't know how to start. So I actually got the opportunity to write my mentor's story. So that's the book that I ghost wrote. And from writing her story and becoming a published author, I've gotten so many writing opportunities and just people that trust me with writing their work. And so that's my writing side. And then I have another, so I basically have two careers, writing and then management. And with management, it's still really the same passion. Like, I love being in the industry, just not my face being present in it. Mm-hmm. So I develop talent. I help people build their brands, create content, and just package brands in the best way where we can present it and get deals, land campaign jobs. So yeah, I would say my passion is kind of putting people on and making sure that people get to where they want to be. Like, if I could be a pivotal resource in somebody else's life, that makes me the happiest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'll piggyback off of Ash. Yeah, I always kind of knew I wanted to be a writer. And so my trajectory at Dorsey's, especially after Dorsey, was like not really unconventional, because like, young, black, from the hood is traditional, but you know, overall scope, it was unconventional. So like, I ended up getting locked up for 2 years when I got arrested before my high school graduation. I was mad, I missed prom and everything. I'm still mad about that. But so I was in these nonprofit organizations. I was coming into juvenile halls. It was an organization called Inside Our Writers. And so they were just a catalyst to use creative writing, as a catalyst to reduce recidivism. And so I was just in that program. I became kind of like a standout student. I even made the, someone's calling me. Just through that program, when I was incarcerated, I have like tons of just notebooks of just poems, writings. We would do like open mics at the juvenile halls where all the parents could come out. Then when I came home, I joined what's called their alumni program, where they basically help us reintegrate into society. Like, simple things as getting your ID, mm-hmm. social security, checking into college, job training. And so fast forward, I came up through there, but because we were all formerly incarcerated, in addition to, you know, like trying to change our lives, we were also advocates for juvenile justice. So we like went to city council meetings at the California State Capitol. Like, we talking with legislators, sharing our stories, say, hey, vote for this bill. This is gonna give youthful offenders second chances. This is gonna try kids as kids. I even been to the White House in a meeting with one of the advisors to Obama. At Morehouse, I met with Joe Biden in a private roundtable discussion. I've been on countless panels throughout the country. I've been on panels with like congressmen and police chiefs, and that always tripped me out because they be looking at me like, what you doing here? I'd be looking at them like, what you doing here? You know, like, I'm the real expert, you know, I live this life y'all trying to judge us about. But that's a whole nother story. So writing was my passion, was my career, juvenile justice. And fast forward now, I just implemented the both when I found my own media company, because I was tired of applying for CNN and LA Times. So I said, I'm going to just add the writing component to what I was already doing with photography. I had got tired of being behind the camera sharing my story. So I was like, let me pick up the camera. So yeah, writing, juvenile justice, and film and photography.
Nice. I guess I'll piggyback off of Alton. First, I want to say that was a great story. I feel like, you know, to the youth that's listening, that's just a great example of, you know, how you can still become somebody and make an impact, you know, even though you're beginning stages may start off rough. But to answer the question, like, holistically, I want to say that career path choosing doesn't always look like going to a college and then choosing a degree or choosing a profession. Had somebody told me that when I was, you know, coming out of high school, I wouldn't have been so hard on myself for not succeeding in college. I went to college and it wasn't that, you know, college was a bad experience. It just didn't work for me. And, you know, I was walking with this pressure, like, if I don't go through college, I'm going to be a failure, you know? And so, you know, career path for me was actually getting a job in the space that I wanted to be in. I got hired to build an app. At the time, the app was very similar to Uber. This was 2017, 2018. I got offered a job to build an app. And then secondly, I want to say that to the high school, to the high school students right now, you don't choose your career path when you get out of high school. You can choose that now. And I say that because when I was in Dr. Mahdi's class, it was like I felt purpose there. I felt like a deep sense of passion. I felt like this was something I could do forever, programming robots and building, you know, robots from scratch. That was something I really enjoyed doing. And so that helped me make the decision, like, okay, I want to take this job and I want to take it to the next level. So after my college experience, you know, I got hired to build this app, and that really set the tone for the career path that I was in. The app was for a manufacturing business, and you know, I ended up, you know, becoming like the president of the manufacturing company at 19 years old, because I was doing so well in my craft. I was, you know, really, I was just doing so great, you know, that I just kept moving up the ladder in that corporate sense as well. So I got a lot of corporate experience from that. And so fast forward today, like, I'm doing the same exact thing, but, you know, it's more personal. So I'm not just working for somebody, but I'm working for myself doing manufacturing. So that's my experience with the career path choosing.
Okay, wait, Roman, talk about the designer bags, the bags that are like where, like, can you talk a little bit about that?
I'll give you guys like an exclusive tour, actually.
Nice, exclusive tour.
Ooh, yeah, I'll give you guys a little tour of my inventory room. Hold on 1 second.
True creative.
So, I manufacture bags in Africa, and this is my small inventory room. These are some of my bags that I produce, manufacture, design. I start my designs digitally, so I create them on a tablet computer, and then I have a manufacturing business in Africa, and we actually hand make everything that you see here. I design everything too, so it's fun. I wouldn't call myself a designer. Like, I didn't start this business to be a designer. It was just a part of the craft. So I have like a lot of unique things. That, you know, that are here. But I started doing digital art. That's what got me into bag making. I started doing digital art. One day I was in like my uncle's office, who's a doctor. And at the time, I thought my purpose was going to be, you know, in health and nutrition, because I felt so much passion about it. And so, honestly, you know, I was kind of feeling weary, like, okay, you know, God, if my purpose isn't to be a doctor, then like, what am I good at? Because, you know, I feel like I'm doing this, but I'm not making as much progress as I could be. And literally moments after me asking that question, I downloaded this app and I started doing digital art. And so that digital art experience is what led me to bag making. And let me show you guys my first product, actually, and then I'll be done talking.
Cool.
So this is my first product that I created. It's a chest bag.
Nice.
Oh, wow. And it holds the, show you. It holds the Apple Pencil, which is what you use to design on a tablet.
Mm-hmm.
And it also holds the AirPods. I don't have my AirPods on me, but the AirPods will go in this section right here. And it also holds the Apple tablet. So you install, you put the Apple tablet here in the zipper part. And this is a different tablet. It's larger, but you know, it would fit. The smaller one would fit on the inside. And that was literally everything that I used to, pioneer my entrepreneurship business about 2 years ago. And so I came up with the idea to design a bag just to hold those items.
Nice.
And like 2 years later, now I have a whole product line in retail stores, have a website, partnership with Shopify. I also started doing architecture. This is why I'm saying, like, to the students, it's so important for you to choose now what you want to do. And you can choose. It's okay to, like, you know, commit to something. And if you don't know, that's okay as well. But, a lot of this inspiration that I have today came from being in Dr. Mai's class and being exposed.
Mm-hmm.
And so I recently started doing architecture. That's something that I didn't know I could do, but I could do. And now that the technology is available, it's so easy to, it's like I'm doing architecture stuff now.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to buy a building in Leimert Park for like $6 million right now.
Yep.
And I was the one to create the architectural drafting for that building. Mm-hmm. I never went to school for this. I didn't go to college for this. This is something that, you know, I self-taught myself using a tablet and a pencil.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm doing architecture stuff. So it's like, I don't know what's happening next, but you know, technology was just something I was passionate about. And that's it.
It's pretty dope. Thank you for giving us that tour, that exclusive tour. That was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Lario?
I just want to say, Roman, great story. I think that's beautiful. Like, you've been able to design from the tablet. And I feel like this definitely pushes towards our children nowadays, or even our high school students, and moving time with innovation.
Yeah.
You're able to create something from a tablet and then be able to make it into a physical thing. Mm-hmm. At that point. And I feel like that's the biggest struggle of what our students have. What's a career path I can choose, that something that can be successful? You stated there's multiple ones you can do, and you actually don't have to choose one specific. You basically chose one and made five. So that's great. Mm-hmm. So I also want to say, what was I going to say? Okay, about me. Yeah. Sorry. So out of Dorsey, I did not know what I wanted to do. I just knew I was really good at softball. I'm going to school, and softball is everything, and that's just what it is. That's literally what my mindset straight out of high school. And then I told myself, okay, I thought I wanted to stay in athletics, so I had majored in kinesiology. I thought I wanted to stay really close to the sport, because as an athlete, you just always think, everything is just sports from this point in my life. Everything after that, there's nothing outside of sports. After my second year of playing softball and kind of going through the whole kinesiology thing, I then was like, I don't think I want to, you know, be that close to the sport. I love the sport, but I don't think I want to be that close anymore. So I then started to focus on myself and think about things that I was just naturally good at. I knew that I was good at helping people. I was good at being a listening ear for people. I knew that I cared about if someone had issues, anything. I just knew those were little traits that I knew I cared about. So I started to look more into psychology. So I ended up majoring in criminal justice with an emphasis in psychology, because originally I thought I wanted to be in some type of form of juvenile police force with children. But later on, I then figured out I wanted to be a therapist. So out of Marymount, I then became a behavioral therapist. I worked with children ages 5 to 17 on any level of the spectrum, whether it was low level autistic, high level autistic, or even if it wasn't any autistic trait, anything behavioral. From me going through that company, I was with that company for about 2.5 years, and I started to notice things while I was working there. I noticed a lot of our black and brown children were diagnosed when they were evidence signs that I didn't see, off of just, if I'm going off a textbook form of how they diagnosed us as well. And I found it to be an issue, a problem. So then I was like, you know, I want to widen my scope and I want to now work with adults. I want to widen myself up a little bit. Let's see what the adult pool does. So I then decided to, I recently switched over jobs and started working for one of the biggest companies in Los Angeles County, CABA, which is the Center for Behavior Analysis, which works with all levels of behavior with children in school and out of school and adults. So from this, I've been able to really get a really big scope on how we're viewed, you know, and some of the cases that I've come across are not just simply just simple diagnosis cases of maybe something's wrong with the child. I do think our Black and brown children maybe sometimes don't have a listening ear. And so you may not be able to identify that outburst was because he didn't eat the day before. Or you didn't identify this because of a certain situation. And I think I am now going to be that middle person for that. That then made me want to now start my own ABA company, which is an applied behavioral analysis company. I would like to start it in West LA area. There's not enough ABA companies in this area. There's only like the big mainstream ones, but there's not a lot that gravitate to us or catapult to low income children or families that are just seeking help. And most of those insurances that we all have, those places don't cover them at all. So that is what pushed me into my MBA program. So now I can now get a scope on the business side of how to go about this. And also knowing that I grew up in this area, I'm more relatable to the children here, from all the way from the youth age, all the way to working with 30 and 40 year old married couples at this point. And it's not just simply being a therapist, it's simply looking at their environment and seeing what's something that about their environment that could be changed, something that may evoke a certain behavior, may change something. So that's been my biggest thing in career path that I've kind of catapulted into. And I'm really passionate about helping. I'm really passionate about helping our community for sure. That definitely is why I moved companies. The company before I was working for was a primarily white company, maybe 2 or 3% Black. I didn't work with a lot of Black and brown children at that time. And when I did work with those Black and brown children, it would be on a completely different spectrum. Than the level that I was used to. So that's another reason why I moved back and moved jobs back down to LA County to stay connected with the community and help our children. I want to help. I want to be here to, I want to be that person, that listening board for that child, for that family that may just need that little extra help, because we're always going to need that assistance. And I don't want my program or my company to be looked at as a program where people can't come for help. And where you can't come for help for financial reasons. And I think that's a really thing I'm heavily passionate about, because those were barriers I saw when I was in school, or barriers I saw with people around me or even my peers that no one kind of helped out with, or if the help was there, no one went to go seek it. So I definitely feel that me trying to open up this ABA company in the West LA area will definitely do justice for myself and helping the community as well.
I really love that, y'all, and the inspiration behind the career path that y'all chose to go, you know, pursue. So what would y'all tell the younger you at Dorsey, you know, as the years have gone by with all of the wisdom that you have gained now, right. What would you tell the younger you at Dorsey High School?
I'll go. When answering this question, I'm trying to think, like, what would I also tell the younger me? Like, but for the youth out there, you know, I would just say, it sounds cliche maybe, but find your passion, you know, whatever you think it is that you love, even if it is sports or the arts, you know, but we do need more Black youth and, you know, other fields. That's because that's all we tend to be known for, sports, the arts. Then it's like, you know, there's nothing wrong with that at all, but we need more scholars. And so, but with that said, find something that you love, no matter what it is. Find a way to monetize it, find a way to sell it, find a way to just help people, if it's a service, whatever it may be. Just find what your passion is. Think of what it is that you love that you can make a career out of. Because we're in an age where I feel like me personally, I don't like to chase money, but we need money. Like, we're living America. It's a capitalistic society. Everything is for profit, for gain. And so I feel like once you find the balance, doing something you love, but while also able to monetize it, then I feel like you'll have it made. And also, I would say for sure, it's kind of like when I was locked up, and it's identical to what Roman was saying, was it's like, oh, well, when I get out of jail, you know, then I'm gonna change my life. It's like, no, you can change it like right now before you get out these gates, because this is practice. When you get out there, it's game time, more than likely. But however you practice is going to translate to game time, you know? And so I feel like, but at the same time, if you don't know what it is you want to do, don't worry about it. Like, just keep going to school, keep meeting people. It's a saying, you know, it's, I forget how it goes, but it's not necessarily what you know, it's who you know. So once you learn the power of network, you know, you've all met us now. Get our contacts, reach out to us, ask us for advice, ask us, do we need any interns, mm-hmm. any staff or anything like that? I would just say reach out. Well, first find your passion. If you don't know what it is, just live life. Like, you know, y'all have Google, like Google things. Like, you can literally, the time you take to ask Facebook a question or your friend, you can literally like Google it, you know, but still get those personal stories from people. I just feel like in life, everything is a balance. So find your passion. And if you can't find it, just live life, meet people, you know, whatever. And I feel like gradually over time, whatever you like, you'll find it. And then once you find it, the right people will gravitate towards you. It's all like an energy thing, mm-hmm. you know? Yep. But don't worry about it if you don't know what you don't want to do right now. Like, go to college, even if you don't go to college, or go to community college, go to a trade. Like, it's 2022. Like, it's so many ways to just find a career path, you know? And I just feel like just because we're young and black and brown, you know, we have to work twice as hard to get half of what the others have, you know? So just keep it in mind, you know, find your passion, you know? If you don't know what your passion is, just keep going and it's gonna find you. Just don't give up and don't be discouraged. Nice. And don't worry about social media either. Like, mm-hmm. people be on social media all day discouraged. Like, oh, they do this, they're 18, they got $1 million. They stay in your own lane. What the title say? Like, pave your own lane, you know, work at your own pace and compare yourself to your life last year, if anything. And if you do look at others' life, look at it in hopes of motivation. That's what I do. I don't look at them like, oh, wow, how did they get that? Or they don't deserve that. No, how did you get that? You know, like, you mind telling me? And when you do meet people in these places or these positions, I'm gonna end with this. When you meet people in like places where you wish to be, or they're farther along than you, more established in their careers, yeah, it's cool to ask for money or whatever, a job. But what I find when I meet people in those places, they give you more when you just pick their brain, when you just ask for advice. Like, you know, the same question we're asking now, answering now, like, what advice would you give the younger you setting out, you know? But, yeah, I've been talking, so I'll end it with that. My bad.
Those are really, really good ones. They're actually, like, a lot of my favorite ones. One of my favorite ones that you said is, don't compare your life to other people, because I feel like you really just have to trust your own process and just know, like, some of the things you have to go through, you might have to go through them longer to really understand why you're supposed to be here on this earth. And if you're looking to the left or right, like, you might miss that message that's for you, or you might miss that little sign that could really traject your whole career a million times forward. So for sure, trust the process. But a big one for me that I wish I would have just got a long time ago is just focus. Like, if I would have just focused on myself and put the type of energy in myself that I do now when I was at Dorsey, I would have been way, way further along. But, you know, you worry about relationships or friendships or drama or family things to get in the way. But you really just have to be able to tune everything out and really just focus on yourself and being better than who you were yesterday or last week or last month. So if you just focus on your own path, don't look to the left or the right or what somebody else is doing or how fast they did it. You will literally, I don't know if you guys saw that quote, but it's like in 6 months, your whole life can change with extreme focus. And that is so, so true. It is literally one of the most true quotes I've ever seen, because if you really just put your mind to something and every day you're working towards it, you're writing down goals daily, you're seeing what's working, what's not working, and if it is working, like, keep doing it, you will get so, so, so far. But looking to the left and right, it will slow you down tremendously. So that's mine.
Can I just say one thing real quick? What Ash said, I feel like focus. So, like, I will add to that, just be determined. Like, even if it's a job, a gig, your career, I would say be determined, because when I got out of jail, I immediately went to community college. I started taking journalism classes. And so I was commuting from Crenshaw and King, getting on the 210, get off at Hollywood Vine, get on the train, get off in North Hollywood, then I would get on another shuttle to take me to LA Valley. And I'll be at the bus stop in the morning seeing all the dudes from the neighborhood, and it's like, I gotta go. I'm seeing the same dudes who I was hanging out with or like just a few years ago, and not like that, but they're in the same spot. And so it's like, then I'm going to community college an hour and a half away. Once I leave there, I'm on the train going to Union Station, getting on another train, going all the way to Altadena, because I work for LA County Parks and Rec. But with that said, it was just like, my mentality was, I can't still be in the jungles. I can't still be in the same neighborhood where I previously got caught up in. Like, I was facing a life sentence for a crime I did not commit. So knowing that, that changed my whole trajectory, like, after incarceration and after Dorsey. So my determination was different. And I'm sure y'all have your own experiences, struggles, setbacks. Use all of that as motivation to be determined in whatever you do. And I have homies that I don't like to say it, but they be telling me, like, dude, you pass us up. And it's like, not that that's what I was trying to do. I was just trying to make a better life for me, because I had, you know, went down the gutter, essentially, you know. But, yeah, what Ash said, like, be focused on whatever it is that y'all do. Like, and start now, you know, if you haven't already.
Yes. Lario, Penny.
What I would tell my younger self, Ashley, and both Alton had great points. Definitely focus on yourself. Same thing, piggybacking off what Ashley said, that if I would have focused on myself the way I do now, back when I was in high school, things could have been very different, but we are here today. We are here today. And I'm thankful for those lessons, but I definitely think just staying true to your story. Like, even if you've gone through stuff, and as we all have, like, stand on your story. Let this be why you want to do what you want to do. Push yourself. And I think I would have definitely told my younger self to just, you know, it's okay to not have it all figured out. It's okay that you don't know exactly what you want to do when you graduate. So I think that's something that we have to understand too, as being in high school, that love what you love. Don't love something that someone is pushing upon you. Same thing as how we feel about college. You know, everyone trajectory is very different, you know, when it comes to school and their career paths. So learn to love something, or love something that you love, not because someone is pushing this career path on you or pushing a passion on you that you may not even have. And those are things that I found, of things I may have doing that I did and did not like. It was things that I was doing for a long time because I was told to do these things all the time, but I didn't really like them, where I wasn't really passionate about those things for myself. So I definitely think staying focused, not looking to the left or the right, being the outsider from your friend group is a good thing, you know, just like Alton, being that person like, hey, catch y'all later when I get back on the bus coming back here, but I gotta go take care of some stuff, you know. That's the same situation me and Camry were in, you know, every day, you know. But those are the steps that you want to take, and those are the things that a Dorsey does support us with, as, you know, wanting to go out, wanting to go explore yourself. Those things are there. So I definitely think that I feel like my younger self took advantage of that, but I would have definitely told myself to stay more connected with the adults and the mentors that I had. Because when you get about 24, 25, and you think you reminisce and you think about those times, those lessons that you had, or those mentors you ran into along those ways. And I definitely think staying connected to people will help you through your life, even if it's just a listening ear, even if it's just advice, you know, staying connected with your high school, and definitely where you got most of all your upbringing from, is something you need to stay connected with for sure. So staying connected to people, staying focused, and focused meaning that doesn't mean shut everything down, you can't go anywhere. No, focus just means on be passionate about what you're doing. Stay determined. You want to be there in 6 months? Let's do it. 6 months. You got 6 months. You know, stay on yourself. Be in competition with yourself. Don't be in competition with anyone else. You were here 2 months ago, so we shouldn't be here anymore 2 months ago. You should be here. If your GPA last semester was 2.8, okay, you should be at a 3.0 or above by the time you graduate. You know, set those goals for yourself, because that way it keeps you always striving for more and pushing for more. Goal setting is another big thing that I wanted to bring up, because that was something I kind of missed in high school. I did gravitate to a lot of things, but I didn't have personal goal sets for myself leaving high school or anything like that. So I definitely think having those personal goal sets for yourself will help you a lot when you get out. So I don't mean to talk everybody's ear off, but yeah, definitely just focus and hone in on yourself, you know?
Yeah.
You have a lot of support.
Mm-hmm. Be here.
All right, I guess I'll go. So I think one of the biggest keys to being successful is being focused. I've learned to define or redefine a couple of words, and one of those words is focus. I believe that focus isn't something you do, it's more of a place. And I say that because you can be on campus, outside during lunch, trying to do your homework. How much focus do you have there versus being in the library where it's like super quiet? So I've learned that focus is actually a place, and you know, it's a place you go, and it's intentional, you know. But you know, I think one of the biggest challenges in high school is community. And I think, you know, because the way the world is, you know, our culture, if we as youth, like follow our culture closely, we won't get very far. And that's not to say that our culture isn't valuable, but there's just things that we glamorize. Like, for example, how many of you in school right now are worried about your shoes, are worried about your clothes? You know, it's not because you want to be, but it's because that's the way the culture is. And so just, you know, taking that time to realize, you know, like community is important. I feel like during my high school time, if I was to allow like the cool kids or, you know, a group of my friends to influence me to do something I didn't want to do, I would be in a position that I don't want to be right now. So that's why I was speaking on culture, because just because something appears to be cool to do doesn't mean you should do it. And, you know, I just feel like the youth right now, that's, if I could talk to my younger self, I would explain to myself, you know, like, you don't have to do what your friends do. You know, you don't have to follow what everybody else is doing. You don't have to wear shoes to be cool or to be valuable or to be liked. You know, so just, it's that community aspect for me, I feel like is really important to understand. You know, also I can say the friends that I had in high school is probably like one person that I keep in touch with from school. So it's funny because I think I've been in a couple of sessions in high school where people from the group older than us that graduated said the same thing. They're like, yeah, the people that you hang out in high school, you're not gonna see them, you know, in real life. And I look at my friend like, man, you know what I'm saying? You my nigga, we ain't, you know, but today is, that's not the reality. And, you know, if I was to really be focusing on myself, you know, as it's been said already, I would be much further. But, you know, everything happens for a reason. I do want to say, though, you know, just as a testimony, when you focus on yourself, when you focus on your craft, the community that your heart desires comes to you. And I have some pictures here, some pictures in front of me that I don't know if you guys will be able to see, but if you can see this blue fabric, that's what was used in one of my last productions, those bags that are in my inventory room. This guy right here is one of the co-founders of the company. He's also my best friend. He's like a brother, he's like a father, he's like such an amazing person in my life. Like I'm at that point where I'm learning like money isn't the real value in life, it's people. Having somebody like him by my side has just been such a blessing. Also, these are other guys in the background that are like family, they're like friends. So if you focus on yourself and you craft yourself and you take that time to, you know, go in a library and just work on what it is that you want to work on. Find a space. Like, I can tell you, when I was in Dr. Mai's class, I began to skip lunch and recess to spend time in his class, just wanting to get ahead in this robotics program. We had a competition coming up, and I think we had like 6 months to prepare. And I would spend my lunch nutrition trying to
wait.
Like, make sure, you know, that
Roman, I don't want to interrupt your story, but I kind of have to. You want to make time for the students to ask questions if they do have questions,
sure.
I already know it was going to be good, so I had to stop there, you know?
Okay. Yeah.
All right, then, y'all. We can do what we did last session and put the questions in the chat, or however y'all like it to be. Go ahead and let me go to the general chat. Just drop them in there if students have any questions. Where's the thing? Where's my chat? Let's go down. Okay. Let's see. I think I got a message. Okay. Alton put his contact information down there. Okay, a question I did have another question on for y'all just in case though is, oh, thank you. Thank you, Coach Dave. Thank you. Thank you. What would you, what lessons in Black history have empowered you all the most? You know, it is Black History Month. What lessons have empowered you all that you've learned?
I think Dr. King, for me, there's a speech that he has on YouTube. He talks about, you know, how a man should be judged by his commitment to excellence. That's changed my life. I listen to it when I'm running, and you know, it's also a speech called Crystal Stairs. Those two speeches have really impacted the way. They're very relevant today, even though it was spoken so many years ago. They're very relevant today. But Dr. King he's really a great speaker.
Nice.
Roman, I'm so glad that you mentioned that, because a lot of our babies do not know who Dr. Martin Luther King was. Wow. So it's so great to hear a young person like yourself talk about him so they can read about him. So thank you so much.
Ironic, I thought that most kids would only know about Martin Luther King and nobody else.
Well, the real Martin Luther King was a radical. I mean, that's why the FBI had him, you know, assassinated. I mean, I think that's the Martin Luther King we don't hear enough about in school, is we just hear the I Have a Dream MLK and not the one who was preaching about economic, you know, equality for everybody. But yeah.
I would definitely say Dr. King too. Honestly, that was part of the reason I wanted to go to Morehouse, which is where Martin Luther King graduated from. I don't know, but just getting older and seeing documentaries like Hidden Colors, and you learn so many things. Not to say I feel bad, but when I learn more African history, I get more mad at the world, because it's like, why wasn't we taught these things? Like, why did I have to learn this when I'm 25 years old, 24, you know? But Yeah, but Martin Luther King, man, a lot of people don't like him because he was about nonviolence. And, you know, people feel like, how can we be so peaceful or nonviolent when we're met with violence every step of the way? But the ideology behind it was that, you know, we're going to be so powerful in our peace that it's going to reveal your evil, you know. But the black history I want to focus on now is just us recognizing our black history is American history, and just taking, not really blaming the system so much no more. We already know it. My thing is like, not necessarily self-responsibility, but just self-acknowledgement. Like, let's just get to it. We don't need no more seminars, no more panels. Like, we know the solutions. Like, you know, let's just band together, use our own resources, and get to it, you know? But it ain't that easy, I guess.
Yes, thank you, thank you. Good, Larry. Oh, wait, real quick, Coach Dave. Yes, I will share my contact information.
What? Wait a minute, you typed that, man. This is, wait, hold up. Okay, can I say something?
Yes.
Okay, so this is Coach Davis. Hey, man, y'all be quiet. This is Coach Davis. I'm so proud of all of you. You know, it's just incredible. You know, everybody, Roman, you, Camry, bringing this together. L'Oreal, the outstanding athlete. Ashley, you've done a great job. And Brother Alton, I think your story is just absolutely incredible, man. It just really is. And see, that's what we need. We gotta be genuine. We gotta be real with ourselves. And see, we gotta put things into motion now. It's not about talk no more. See, we've had all of these talks before. At this point in my career, I'm done talking. It's like, we need strategies and we need action plans for what we're going to do. And see, you guys have a strategy and have an action plan just by doing this. And see, I think that's fantastic, man. I'm just like really inspired by you. And also, I think that we need to look at ways that we can empower the young people and, you know, give them specific tasks that they need to do. You guys have done all of that on this call, man. You got it all outlined. I think you guys have the right idea. I think if y'all had y'all own school, if you guys were the administration for the school, okay, based on what you're saying on this call right here, I think things could be really effective. So I'm going to be consulting with you and getting some ideas, because you guys is where the ideas has to come from, man. The younger generation, we need the ideas from you. So keep doing your thing, man. I'm really proud of you guys.
Thanks, Coach Dave. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Coach Dave.
Yeah, thanks, Coach Dave.
Thank you. Yeah, for real. Thank you.
We have I'm just filled with joy. I got tears in my eyes. You guys are amazing. You give us so much hope. We have 3 minutes left. Is there anything else you would, the panelists, the guest speakers, my babies would like to say? Because you guys have always been my babies, no matter how old you are.
I wanted to actually answer one of the questions that were in the chat that Maharaji had put for one of our students.
Sure.
The question was, would... one of the students named Summer would like to hear who your support system was at Dorsey to motivate you to go to college. My particular support system to motivate me to go to college was Coach Dave. Coach Dave was the biggest pusher to go to college, and it was Scholastics coupled with athletics. And as far as system, there were very specific teachers that honed in on me about the state on top of my work, that wouldn't let me turn in sloppy work. For instance, Ms. Habarachi was another big person that we had multiple conversations about schooling. Another professor I had at Dorsey that talked about college a lot was Donald Singleton. He's very, very prone on like doing what you need to do, you know, getting it done, you know. So those were just a couple of my support people at the school. Also, I'm not sure if he still works there now, but Mr. Wilder was a very big, he was a dean at that time when I was going there. He was very a pinnacle person on pushing college on me as well.
Wait, let me piggyback right after that. So L'Oreal Klein was actually the inspiration for why I went to college. to be honest with y'all, I never even thought about college up until, like, I saw her. She was applying. I saw her going to, like, the college center, the career center. And I'm like, what's she doing? Like, why is she applying for the SAT? Like, I kind of was just, like, whatever, nonchalant about everything, you know? And I actually applied to San Jose State because her brother, she told me, went there. So that was really just my end door there, because I was watching my best friend, you know, take that leadership because she saw her brother go to college. And it's just like crazy, you know, how that chain works. But yeah.
Real quick, I didn't know. I always knew I was going to go to college, but at Dorsey, it wasn't my focus. I don't remember going to the college resource center. Like, I don't remember none of that. I'm like, did it exist? But that just wasn't my focus.
It was there. It was in that building. It was that last building on the it was there.
I think I remember being in there once, but support system, I don't know if he's still on here, but Mr. Speaks, he taught drama, and his class was like a club or activity. I love Mr. Speaks because he didn't judge us. He always encouraged us to go to HBCUs. Yeah, I swear that was one class I felt like I could just be me, you know? And shout out to Miss Haparaji too. I see you on here. She used to give me a hard time at Dorsey. Or I used to give her a hard time, should I say.
No, for sure. Speaks class was always just a class where you could go and just unwind. It was really like a community, like literally family. And he still supports all of us till this day. Like, he follows all of us, he taps in, he shares our work. So it's just the Dorsey community. Like, everyone still supports you. And to this day, I wouldn't want to graduate from any other high school. So,
sure. Like, when I'm in college or just I meet other people, a lot of them don't still know their friends from high school and stuff. I'd be like, it's like we all grew up together. All I do is still
we grew up together.
People
with
the middle and high school.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just an LA thing. I don't know.
I think so. Well, thank you all. I know y'all got another period to go to. So, Mama Dorsey, thank you so much. I saw your message. Thank you to my guests. Thank you to the students, the teachers, everyone that helped, you know, put this together. I hope we get to do something like this next year for Black History Month and have more guest people come and speak. So, yeah, we love you all. Like we said, it's DDP for L. So, you know, you just can't hide that Dorsey pride. Thank you all. I'm going to...
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. We're gonna be in touch. We got work to do, you guys.
Miss Long?
I was here.